Let's talk about the potential difference of two or more components connected in a series in a circuit. Let's look at several components connected in series. Let's take a battery in series with a capacitor, in series with a resistor. And let's look at points in between and on either side of each component. I'll call the point to the left of the battery point A, the point between the battery and the capacitor point B, the point between the capacitor and the resistor point C, and the point between and the point on the opposite side of the resistor point D. In looking at this, know that the battery is at a point of low potential. Well, let's look at the potential difference across each of these components. So the potential difference across the battery, we'll say, is the potential difference from A to B. The potential difference from A to B is just the difference in potential between the positive terminal of the battery and the negative terminal of the battery. And then the potential difference of the capacitor is the potential difference from B to C. So again, that potential difference across the capacitor from B to C is the difference in potential between the potential at point C and the potential at point B. And then the potential difference of the resistor is the potential difference from point C to D. So V sub CD, the potential difference across the resistor, is the potential at point D minus the potential at point C. The thing about the voltage of two or more components connected in series, the voltage may be added together. So what that means is if we wanted to know the total voltage from A to D, we would just have to add up the voltage from A to B plus the voltage from B to C plus the voltage from C to D. Now, in adding up those voltages, notice that it's just the voltage at point B minus the voltage at point A plus the voltage at point C minus the voltage at point B plus the voltage at point D minus the voltage at point C. So notice what cancels. The potential at point B, VB, cancels with a minus VB, plus the potential at point C cancels with a minus the potential at point C, and we end up with the potential from A to D is equal to just the difference in potential between the right end of the series combination and the left end. So, with this said, we could say the voltage of two or more components connected in series may be added together, and it's equal to the voltage across the ends of that combination of components. Now, this comes from conservation of energy. Conservation of energy tells us that the potential difference between two points in a circuit is equal to the sum of the potential differences between any number of successive pairs of points between those two points. So let's talk more about potential difference of components connected in parallel. Two or more components that are connected in parallel have the same potential difference between their ends. This is because the potential difference between two points, A and B, is path independent. That is, it is equal to the potential difference between A and B taken along any path between A and B. So, for example, let's look at these three components that are all in parallel with each other. We have a combination of two batteries in parallel with the resistor, in parallel with a capacitor. Now, we can recognize that all of these components are in parallel with each other is because each of them share the same two points in common on opposite sides of the components. Let's label one of these points point A, and let's label another point B. Point A, being attached to the negative terminal of the battery, we can say has a potential of V sub A because that negative battery terminal maintains point A at potential V sub A. And the positive terminal of the battery is maintains point B at the potential V sub B. And this is because point B is attached via an ideal wire to the positive terminal of the battery. Point A is attached via an ideal wire to the negative terminal of the battery. That ideal wire, the potential everywhere in that ideal wire is constant. So the potential difference from point B to A is given as, in this situation, the potential difference of the battery terminals. But notice we can get from A to B along any path we want. We can get from A to B starting from point A, going through the battery and ending up at point B. Or we can get from A to B going through the resistor. Or we can get from A to B going through the capacitor. Notice that since potential is independent of path, it doesn't matter how you get to point B. What matters is the value of potential at point B in relation to the value of potential at point A. And because the values at each of those points remains the same, the potential difference across the resistor is equal to the potential difference across the capacitor, is equal to the potential difference across the battery, because each of these components are in parallel. And remember, components in parallel have the same potential difference between their ends. Two or more components connected in parallel may have different currents flowing through them. Well, think about a river. So imagine you have a single river. Now, this river has current, has water flowing through it. Now, all of a sudden, let's take that same river and let's branch it. We'll still have the same amount of water, but when we look at the branch, when we look at the current, the amount of current entering that branch will split between the narrow branch, so you're not going to have as much current in the narrow branch. The lower branch here might have a dam. This dam is going to maybe cause this, water to flow out, but in a different amount. And then this middle fork might have the most amount of current going through it. So the total amount of current is still what we started with, but because different branches, one branch is narrow, doesn't allow a lot of current through, one branch is wide, allows more current through, the total amount of current is the same. The point being, the total current is a combination of the currents of each of these branches. And when you give current a choice of multiple paths, it'll try and take all the paths. However, most of the current will go through the path that is of least resistance. Now, in regards to our circuit, same thing. Different amounts of current can flow simultaneously through each component. So if we have our battery, and let's say our battery is in parallel with a resistor, and in parallel, in this case, let's say a light. Well, if we look at the current through the circuit, let's call the current in the branch that the battery is on, let's call that I. So that current flowing in that branch is going to split between current flowing through the resistor and current flowing through the light. Now, those two currents will recombine, giving us the same current that we started off with. We can't lose current because the current into a particular branch is equal to the current coming out of that branch. So the current leaving the battery going into the branch between the resistor and the light is equal to the sum of the currents going through the resistor and the light, which recombines, giving us our original current back. So even though the potential difference between each of these components is the same, because these components are each connected in parallel, they may have different currents because they inhibit the flow of charge by different amounts. So, in general, in talking about currents, consider that most of the current in a circuit will take the path of least resistance. And that's natural. We don't like barriers in our way. So if we see a barrier ahead of us, we want to try and go around it. Same is true of current. Most of the current will take the path of least resistance. So given a choice between two paths, one of high resistance and one of lower resistance, most of the current will travel along the path of least resistance, leaving a smaller amount of current to pass through the rest of the circuit. So this is where we could kind of do a current bypass that we'll call a short. A short in a circuit occurs when a wire is used to bypass one or more components in a circuit, providing an alternative path of lower resistance for current to flow. So in this picture on the left, I have a battery that is attached to a resistor, which is attached to an ammeter, but what's getting in the way is we have a single ideal wire. So that ideal wire provides an alternative path. And in this case, being an ideal wire, there is zero resistance to the flow of current. Since there is zero resistance to the flow of current, the wire completely bypasses the resistor because, as I said earlier, most of the current will take the path of least resistance. Well, all of the current will take the path of no resistance. Now, in our circuit we drew previously, we could create a short in this circuit as well. So if I were to place a wire, let's say I'll place a wire right here. This wire offers a path of zero resistance. So in offering that path of zero resistance, what happens now is that wire short circuits the rest of the circuit. And that short means that none of the current will reach the rest of the circuit if this is an ideal wire, because the rest of the circuit has resistance. An ideal wire has no resistance. In practice, though, our wires have some amount of electrical resistance. Because it has some amount of electrical resistance, even though a lot of current will go through that wire, a little bit of current will still trickle past and make it down the other components of our circuit.